Welcome to those who are maybe visitors with us or not used to being here, and those who are watching and listening along later on. It's great to welcome you all as we worship this morning. Got a couple of announcements and notices that have been on our screens, but just in case you missed them or didn't catch them all. The first is that in a few weeks' time, it's the Queen's Jubilee, around the kind of first weekend of June. And to celebrate that and commemorate that, we're going to host a special Sunday morning service, a theme service, celebrating the Platinum Jubilee. And so I just want to encourage you to invite family, friends, neighbours, folk in the community who might not normally come here on a Sunday, but you know what, they quite like the Queen, quite like the royal family, and they might like to join us. In the same way that many folk join us for Remembrance Sunday, but they might not normally do so. So we want to celebrate that as a community, for all the community, not just for the church, for the whole community. So normal service times, but themed around the Platinum Jubilee. And as part of the Jubilee weekend, many folk in the community were wanting to do something, a street party or the like. And unfortunately, for various reasons, that wasn't able to happen amongst the rest of the community. And so ourselves and the Living Room Church next door are going to put on a Platinum Jubilee celebration on a Sunday afternoon at 2:30 to 4:30 out here in our church grounds. We're going to have games and party stuff. We're going to have lots of food, and we're going to have games and quizzes and some music, as it says at the bottom there. If anyone wants to dress up and win a prize for the best royal outfit, that'd be great as well. And again, we want to encourage everyone. This is not for the church. This is so we can bless our whole community. So we want folk who never show up here on a Sunday morning to show up on a Sunday afternoon. We want to bless them and love them. And as part of that, as I say, there is food. And what we need is for you to maybe contribute towards some of the food. We've got a list of various food items that you've made. And if you feel you could make some things like some cakes or some sandwiches, we'd love it if you could sign up to some. Living Rooms are doing some. We're going to do some. And that'd be very helpful. If you need some expenses paid for that, that's absolutely fine. We can pay your expenses. But if you can just make sandwiches, etc., that'd be great. So details will be at the back, and you can sign up to that. Our thing is that we started on Wednesday our Hope Explored course, our three-week course exploring the Christian faith. If you've not been yet, then you can join us this Wednesday. That's not a problem. Explores what it is to be a follower of Jesus in this day-to-day world. If you've never read the Bible, don't know anything about Christianity, you're still very welcome. We'd love to have you there. Don't have to speak out. You can listen for the whole time if you want. So it's Wednesdays, 10 o'clock, across in the church centre. I think that is all for now. But this morning we're going to think about what it means to be worshipping a generous God and what our response to that should be. So I am going to read a few words from Psalm 36, and then we're going to sing a couple of songs. Okay, so I can flip the right page. Psalm 36, David writes, "Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mountains. O Lord, you look after both people and animal. How priceless is your unfailing love. Both the high and the low among people find refuge in the shadow of your wings." It speaks of how God loves us, God cares about us, God is there for us. I'm going to sing a couple of songs. We're going to sing together, "Jesus is the Name We Honor," and then I will offer up my life.
Thank you.
So we're going to pray, we're going to talk to God, and at the end of that prayer, we're going to use the Lord's Prayer. The words will appear on the screens behind me. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you that you are a good friend to us, that you are a loving King to us. Thank you that you are a God who cares about us, who looks out for us, that you never abandon your people, but you're always there. You never run away, you never abandon us, but wherever and whenever we need you, you are only a prayer away, and you walk beside us in the good times and the sad times of life. So God, we ask this morning that as we come to worship you together, as we leave aside our busy lives for just a wee moment, we ask that we will encounter you today, that we will encounter a friend, a loving King, a good Father to us. God, may you have all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor this morning, that as we sing these songs of praise, as we turn to you in prayer, as we read your Bible and we learn from it, we ask you to speak to us and encourage us and help us to know your goodness in our lives. And may our lives be changed evermore as a result. Forgive us when we've not seen you, when we fail to love you. But God, thank you that you love to bless us and forgive us. And may we know that forgiveness in our hearts today, we pray. For we ask all of these things in the wonderful and the good name of Jesus. And it's in his words that we pray together. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come.
Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I want to ask the boys and girls, and maybe some of the mums and dads, and adults who are here, what are your favourite things in the world? What are your favourite things to do, favourite things to have? What's your favourite things? Yeah, Ollie? Playing football. Anyone else like to play football? Anyone else like to watch football? A few folks like to play and watch football. Yeah, okay. So you like to play sports. Anything else? What else do we like to do? Go on. What's your favourite thing to do or have? What's the best thing about life? Eating chocolate. Who else likes to eat chocolate? There you go. So do you really like it when it's your birthday or Christmas and Easter because you get lots of chocolate? That's good times. Okay. Anything else? What's your favourite things to do? You got a favourite thing? Any of the adults got a favourite thing to do or a favourite thing in their life?
Walking my dog.
Walking the dog. Oh, Betty, what were you going to say?
Cuddle the dog.
Cuddle the dog. Do any of you have any pets? Yeah. Maybe you like to cuddle your pets, unless it's a goldfish, in which do not cuddle your goldfish. Anything else? What else do some of the adults like to do? Or Ollie, you got another one?
Gardening.
Oh, yeah. Some folk like gardening. You've forgotten. I can think of it in a minute. Reading? Oh, okay, lots of good things here. I've brought some things along that helped me to remember some of my favourite things. So somebody mentioned chocolate, and I love to eat cereal. Like, if you ask my wife, all I eat is cereal. I eat cereal in the morning, sometimes I have two bowls, and at night, before I go to bed, I'm like, still hungry. And sometimes she says to me, Kirsty says to me, we just made dinner an hour ago, and I'm like, I'm still hungry. And I always have an extra bowl of cereal before I go to bed. So you like chocolate, I like cereal. That is good. And you mentioned a couple of hobbies. I had football and gardening and walking your dog. What's this? I'll just open it, you might see what it is. What's that? Ollie? It's a map, right? Okay, when might you use a map? When you go on holiday. Yeah, when you go on holiday, or maybe you just like to go out for the day. And that's what I like to do as well. Sometimes I like to go out for the day, or I like to go on holiday, so I brought along my map. And for the 2 days a year when it's sunny, I've got my sun cream with me as well. We were out on the beach yesterday, and we had to put some on Asher. And also, we like the people in our lives, our mums and dads, our friends, our brothers and sisters. And so I've got a picture from Kirsten and I's wedding, when we were about 12 years old, it looks like, compared to now. 5 years ago is a long, long time, it feels like sometimes. And then this is represents Asher, our little boy, and it's his little comfy. Don't worry, he's got a spare one with him this morning. But this reminds me of Asher because he takes that with him everywhere. He's not got it right now, but his spare one is there because he gets upset. He needs it. And Sunday I mentioned gardening and the flowers, and I love flowers as well. There are lots of good things in life. And what I want to remind you this morning, and we'll think about later on with the mums and dads and adults, is that God gives us all of these things. So God gives us our dog to watch and to cuddle and to walk. God gives us the flowers and the plants and the trees and the world around us. God gives us cereal and chocolate. God gives us musical instruments. God gives us sunny days and rainy days sometimes. God gives us all of these things. Why? Because he loves us and he cares about us. So all the good things in your life you can think about, whether it's your mums and dads or your friends or your hobbies or the things you enjoy to eat and do, God gives them to us all. I'm going to say a little prayer, then we're going to sing another song. Let us pray. God, we thank you that you give us lots of good things in life. We thank you for the yummy food that we eat, whether it's breakfast cereal or chocolate or pizza or lots of other yummy things. Thank you for the things that we get to do, to walk the dog and cuddle our pets, to go out for the day, to play football, to watch sports, and all the fun things we have in life. Thank you for giving us our senses to touch things, smell things, taste things, and see things. Thank you for our friends and family, for mums and dads and grands and granddads, for brothers and sisters, for everyone that we know and love and who knows and loves us. Thank you for giving us them all. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We are going to sing one more song before the young folk head out, and we're going to sing together a couple of verses from I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. Boys and girls, you're very welcome to head next door and you can go and have lots of fun at Kingdom Kids. Come to God again in prayer. Let us pray. God, indeed, we thank you that you are a generous God towards us. You're generous in so many ways that if we were to count the blessings, as the song says, and name them one by one, we would be here forever and a day naming each of the things in our life that we can thank you for. We can thank you for each new day, for each new minute, for every experience and every sense that we have. For the warmth of the love of others, the warmth of the sun, the laughter, the joy, and the hope that we have. Thank you for all of these things. Thank you that you are a kind and generous God. And your generosity is shown to us by the fact that you love us and you care about us, that you welcome us into a relationship with you. And so out of that relationship, we bring you our prayers for our world, for our community, for ourselves, asking, pleading that you might change circumstances, that you might intervene in things that seem beyond our control. God, we continue to pray for the people of Ukraine and the situation that is continuing to happen there. We thank you, Lord, that In many parts, there is far less conflict than there once was. But in some areas, it's still as heavy as ever. And so God, may you bring protection to the people of Ukraine. May you turn back the enemy forces. May you bring peace to that country. And I heard after last night's Eurovision win by Ukraine that people were hoping that this time next year, Ukraine might be able to even host the next competition. God, that seems like just a thing that's far too crazy to even imagine. But with you, all things are possible. So God, may that happen. May that country become the bastion of peace in our world. God, we pray for those who are known to us, perhaps even ourselves, who are really worried about energy price rises and the rising prices of fuel for their cars, for food on their plates. God, maybe even many of us who have a steady job, a good income, recognize that it's going to be a slightly tougher year. But for those who already were struggling, this is unbearable. So God, we ask for your provision. We ask that you'll pour out your generosity towards those who particularly need support and care in these days. We thank you for food banks. We wish we didn't have them, but we thank you for them. And we ask, God, that people might be generous to them. That, God, you will use us to be generous. We ask that you might use us as your church to be your hands and your feet. That if we have neighbors or friends or strangers who need help, that we might have you working in us. And that we might be your representatives on earth, bringing a little pocket of heaven to earth as we feed those who are hungry, as we give comfort to those who are struggling. God, for those who are ill, for those who are weary today, we ask your protection for them. A couple and a number have got COVID today, and so we ask you to protect them and that they will be safe and kept well, and they'll be back with us next week. For those who have ongoing health conditions, for those who are awaiting test results and are anxious of the future, bring peace to their hearts, we ask. Shower them with your love. Cover them with your healing wings. May they know the warmth of your embrace, the closeness of your presence. And may you surround them with family and friends, with the people in this church to look after them and care for them, to love them like Jesus. And God, we thank you again for all that you give to us. And we ask, Lord, that we might be generous people, that we might love the lost, that we might care for the lonely, we might tend to the broken, and do so in Jesus' name. For we ask all of these things in his wonderful name. Amen. We're going to have first of a couple of readings, and Susan's going to do them both, but the first one is going to be from Psalm 112, reading the first five verses. It's page 614 in your church Bible. Psalm 112, the first five verses.
Oops. That's okay. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Oh, no, I'm the wrong one. That's a good start. Praise the Lord. Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who finds great delight in his commands. His children will be mighty to the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in this his house, and his righteousness endures forever. Even in the darkness night, light dawns for upright, for the gracious and compassionate and righteous man. Good will come to him who is generous and lends freely. Amen.
Before Susan does our next Bible reading, we are going to sing another song, and we're going to sing again once we've been singing recently, but it might be new to some of us. We're going to sing Jesus Strong and Kind. invite Susan back up to do our second reading, this time from the New Testament, from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, reading verse 6 to 15, page 1163. 2 Corinthians 9, from verse 6 onwards.
Sowing generously. Remember this. Forgot my glasses. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work, as it is written. He has scattered abroad his gifts to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be made rich in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion, and through us your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of God's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, men will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ, and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. And in their prayers for their hearts, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Amen.
Thank you so much, Susan. Both of the passages that Susan read for us talks about what it looks like for us to be generous people, and it speaks about God being generous in bits of it as well. And that's this morning what we're going to think about in over these next few weeks, thinking about what it is to worship a generous God and what it is to be called to be generous people. And I want you to know that as we begin, that our God is a generous God. He's not a kind of sensible, give them exactly what they need, not one bit more kind of God, but a God whose heart overflows with kindness, richness, and desire to bless you. When God gives, he gives his best. And that's so good, so refreshing, so liberating, so challenging for us to remember that. And so for the next few weeks, go through a few weeks thinking about a series called Entrusted, the Generous Heart of God. Because our God is generous, and he entrusts us, he gives us our possessions, our money, our time, our talents, the family situation we have, and all the rest of life. And he asks us to use it to bless and to build up his kingdom of love and grace and goodness across the world. He's generous towards us, giving us far more than we deserve, asking that we use it to bless others. As we thought about the past few weeks, we thought about heaven and how God is wanting to bring heaven to earth. And while we live on this earth right now, we are called to bring little pockets of heaven to earth. We follow the God who loves, and he says, well, because you love me, go and love others. Bring a little bit of pocket of heaven to earth when you bless others and love others and serve others. So I guess following on from that, this is what a generous life looks like. So this morning I want to remind you of what a generous God we have. And if we're going to look at what generosity is, we need to begin with the one who made generosity. God himself. After all, he's the creator of all things, of time and space, of matter, of language, of culture, of everything. And that includes generosity. And there's three ways the Bible tells us about God's generosity, three areas of God's generosity. The first is creation, the second is our daily life, and the third is in salvation. So we're going to go through them all and see how God is generous to us. But before we look at the first one, let me just pause for a moment and let you think about this. That the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, as the Bible describes him, the creator and sustainer of all things, the Almighty, the Glorious One, is generous towards you because he cares for you, he loves you, he looks out for you, his heart is towards you. God is generous towards you. And so firstly, God is generous in creation. Douglas Henry, an academic, talks about how the generosity of God is seen in creation in two ways. Firstly, God creates everything that there ever is and ever was out of nothing. Before anything else existed, there was only God and only him alone. Everything that exists, time and space and matter, resulted or came about as a result of God's generosity. There was no one else there at the time to kind of give him peer pressure. There was no campaigns on the telly going, if you are a God, please give £5 a month to this charity. No one forced him, no one told him. He wanted to do it. He created everything to be generous, to bring life and abundance to others, to you and to me. Everything that exists is only as a result of his extravagant and abundant, generous act of creation. And secondly, Douglas Henry says, God is still generous to us in creation because he still pays attention to you and to me. He engages with creation. And the way that we know that is because if you've ever prayed, you believe that God engages with us, that God's not somewhere up in the sky and folding his arms and watching telly. He's listening out for you, speaking to him. And if you believe that, then you'll pray to him and you'll say, God, help me out because I care, because I think that you care about me. I believe that you care about me. God not only creates and lets loose, but he creates and sustains and renews day by day, minute by minute. He looks out and is looking forward to having you speak to him and engage with him back. Then think about creation itself. He's generous in the way that we have the heavens and the earth and the dazzling variety of valleys and mountains, beaches and oceans, deserts, jungles and glaciers. No wonder the psalmist cries out in praise. All of creation declares the glory of God. And Paul says in 1 Timothy that God gives us everything in our life for our enjoyment. God wants you to look at creation and enjoy creation and all that God made. Think about the sizes, the shapes, and the variety of life on earth. There are more than 18,000 species of bird flying about. This one just amazed me. There are 25,000 species of orchid in the world. I thought there might be like 20 or something. 25,000 species of one type of plant. That handful of sand has about 10,000 grains in it. That there are more stars in the universe than there are bits of sand on all the beaches of the world. We're moving into summer and maybe you are like us and we're trying to do up our garden and get some plants into it. Well, don't worry, because there's 400,000 species of flower out there to enjoy. And if you're hungry, 200,000 species of plants that you can eat. I can name about 40. There are 200,000 species of bananas and strawberries and apples and grapes and pears and plums and everything else, and millions of things you've never heard of that you could eat. The earth in all its richness and variety and shape and size and texture and flavor is there so that you might enjoy it. And that you might see it and enjoy it and go, wow, look at the God who made it all. Because God could have given us six different things to eat. He could have given us two different birds, a penguin that can't fly and an albatross that can. And he went, that's your lot. But no, he gives us all of these species of orchid as well so that you might enjoy them and marvel at God's goodness and generosity. He didn't cut corners or cut costs or do it on a budget. He did it lavishly and abundantly. He gives us all these sights and sounds and touches and tastes so that we can experience the richness of his gifts. So when you think about it and pause long enough, Just the goodness of God's creation should make us marvel and rejoice. But the Bible says there's so much more than just creation for us to rejoice in and to find God's generosity within. For the second thing the Bible says is that God is generous to us day by day, hour by hour, week by week, year by year. That he's generous to us in our daily life, from the large things and the small things to the obvious and the not so obvious. And when I say the not so obvious, did you know that in the last half hour or so since you began and we worshiped together, that God has made your heart beat 2,500 times? That he's caused your lungs to expand and contract about 500 times, just in the last half hour or so? You didn't have to go, come on, heart, keep going, keep going. You didn't have to tell your lungs to move. God made it happen so that you could be here. And he's done it every other half hour of your life. God gives us sun and rain, the warmth of the sun on our back and the coolness and the beauty of the white fields at winter. He's a provider of your food, who brings the moments of joy into your life. And the Bible's full and resplendent of how God gives good gifts to his people. In the story of Abraham, there's a story where Abraham's servant goes to meet somebody else. And the servant goes up to this foreigner, this other person, and he talks about his master, Abraham. He says, let me introduce you to my master, Abraham. And he says, Abraham's got lots of camels and goats and cows and gold and silver. But before that, he says, we worship a God who gave Abraham all the cattle and the goat and the sheep and the camels and the donkeys and the silver and the gold. God gave it to Abraham. Then at the time of Moses, the people of God are looking forward to the land that God might give them after they've been in captivity in Egypt. And they don't describe it as any old home or some decent place to live and be free from slavery. Instead, they say, we're looking forward to the land of milk and honey, a land that overflows with milk and honey. Now, not literally was it going to just be baths of milk and honey, but it's their way of describing blessing and abundance and richness and bounty. They were looking forward to it because God would give all that they would need to them. And if you have had the privilege of being a parent, then the Bible says that your child is a gift from God. Numerous times we see in the Bible folks asking God to give them a child. And if and when it happens, they thank God for the gift of that child. From the moment of conception, as that child grows, the people say, thank you, God, that you've given me that gift. As a child grows and is knitted together in their mother's womb, God is the provider of that blessing to the family and to the world. I'm already a dad to two little boys. Just one of them I've never met yet. Well, I've seen a picture on a screen, but I've never met him. But God's given me that gift of two little boys to be a dad to. And if you're a parent and you have that gift of a child, admittedly, if you're like me, sometimes you don't think they're a gift and they're there to kind of cause you to be upset and tired and broken. But actually look back and see what a gift that child is. And then in the Exodus, as the people are wandering, waiting for the promised land of milk and honey, so often they were struggling. I don't have enough food, I'm in the desert. I don't have enough water, I'm in the desert. And so they pray to God, and he provides for them. The story of a water cascading out of a rock, out of the middle of nowhere. Or food that appears every night for them, and they have enough to eat day by day in the middle of the wilderness. God gives us strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, the song goes. He offers to be your refuge and strength, comfort and joy. He sustains us day by day and offers you protection under the shadow of his wings. The earth is full of his unfailing love. The weary are given unbeatable strength. The downhearted are comforted. God cares, God provides, God is generous. And that's how the Bible describes them, that phrase on the screen, Jehovah Jireh. So often the biblical authors say, God, you are Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides, the Lord who provides for us. Again, pause to reflect and remember that. Like I said before, and you'll maybe know this, but in the world around now, in the next couple of years, there'll be 8 billion people on the planet. 8 billion people. I'm nearly 31. In my lifetime, there's been an extra 2.5 billion people. If you're about 60 or older, then the population of the world has more than doubled in your lifetime. But despite all of these people, 8 billion or so people on earth, God is mindful and cares about you. most of those people will be just as unknown and forgettable as you and I will be, that beyond our great-grandchildren, nobody will remember as much more. But if you think about it, there's lots of famous and important people in the world. All the political leaders, intellectual scientists, discoverers and inventors of life-changing products. Those who will change a course of history, or who have done. But yet, despite so many of those important people, God still cares about you, just as much as he does about the president, or the prime minister, or the explorer, or the scientist. 8 billion people, and yet he looks out for you. He knows you intimately, more than your spouse could ever do so, or you could ever do so for your child. He cares out for you. He looks out for you. He provides for you. So God's generous in creation. He's generous in our daily needs. And lastly, the Bible says, he's generous in salvation. Nothing illustrates a generous giver more than God giving up his son, Jesus, for us. The ultimate gift that brings hope and life and joy forever. That God himself enters into human history, was born in a stable many years ago. God gave us the most precious gift when he gives up his son for us. It was a gift we didn't deserve, didn't earn, but yet we got it because God loves us. And if you think about the life of Jesus, we see the generosity of God being displayed in his life. In the beginning of John's Gospel in chapter 2, there's a story of Jesus going to a party at the wedding at Cana. And there we see the first miracle of Jesus, where he turns, of course, water into wine. And what it reminds us is that God is generous to us, because when he's there, he doesn't turn the water into like a couple of bottles of wine. He fills up all the barrel loads of water into wine. And the wine that's produced isn't some kind of cheap kind of little £3 stuff in the bottom shelf. It's the best wine that anyone has ever tasted before. Even when everyone else is drunk and wouldn't care what they drank, Jesus still gives them the best wine they could ever imagine. When he feeds the thousands on the mountainside, he doesn't ration the food. He gives them a basket full of leftovers. Everyone has a full tummy, and yet he says, I've given you more than even that. In his life, he looks out for the lowly and the outcast. He welcomes the child when everyone says, go away, children, you're peasants, you know nothing about anything. Jesus says, no, let the child interrupt me, come to me. He frequently stops in his busy journeys to tend to the ill and to love the unlovable and to teach the inquirer. He takes time out of his busy day. He's God on earth, he's got stuff to do, and yet he says, you've got a question, let me answer it. You're unwell, let me help you. You're struggling in life, let me be there for you. Jesus displays his love and generosity throughout his life and ministry. But it's most abundantly clear when we remember what he's done for us. Don't we see it most beautifully in salvation that we have? And by that, I don't just mean the death on the cross and his resurrection from the grave for us, but rather because Jesus came to earth in the first place, that he'd already given up his throne in heaven and he came to the darkness and muckiness of life. The Bible says that though Jesus was rich, yet for your sake, he became poor, so that through his poverty, you might become rich. In other words, Jesus came to earth and suffered so that you might never have to suffer. That Jesus came from heaven to earth so that you might go from earth to heaven. It cost him everything. It cost us nothing. And yet we got all the fullness of the benefits for it. That's generosity. And generosity is still given to us by God. For we have the Holy Spirit working in our hearts and in our lives. And when we see the generosity of God and what salvation means for us, it should make us marvel and rejoice. And by that, I don't mean the kind of get out of jail free card, don't go to hell, but go to heaven instead. But rather, I mean that God embraces us and welcomes us as a child, that we have an inheritance in heaven awaiting for us. We have a home with God free from suffering and pain forevermore. As I said earlier, God's generosity is not spurred on by someone cajoling him or pushing him. He does it out of love for you and for me. He wants to bring you into a relationship with him. He didn't have to, but he wants to. He wants to bring a broken world and a broken people back to himself. That's why Paul can say at the end of our second reading, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. What a gift we have from God. So the Bible says God is generous to us in these three ways: in creation, in our daily life, and in the salvation that we can have. But the Bible also says, so what are you going to do about it? We have a pattern to follow, that as God's people, we recognize God has been generous to us, and so we too should be generous towards others. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, a little bit earlier in that book that we read earlier, Paul says about a church in Macedonia, he says, in the midst of their very severe trial, their overflowing joy and extreme poverty welled up into a rich generosity. They gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability. In the midst of a severe trial and extreme poverty, they were able to give even much more than they were able to do so. And Paul says the reason this church could give to God's mission in the world was not because they were nice, not because someone forced them to, but because they loved God, because they wanted to give their whole life to God. And so God was working in their life. In our first reading that Susan read for us from Psalm 112, the biblical author in Psalm 112, verse 5, says this: God will come to those who are generous, or goodwill comes to those who are generous. And at first it might look like it's saying that if you're generous and kind and you give things to other people, then God will like you, that God will do nice things for you. But it's a danger of reading one verse of the Bible without reading the whole chapter. Because the first verse of that we read earlier says this: praise the Lord. Blessed is the one who fears the Lord, or who loves the Lord, and finds great delight in him. In other words, what it's saying is, the people who love God, who give themselves to God, here's the kind of life that they will live. And it goes on to say that they will experience blessing and joy and hope, that they will have a good life, not because they're nice people, but because they will have lives that are changed by God as a result of following after him. It says that they will have they'll be filled with grace and compassion, that they will walk God's ways, that they will be generous and just in all that they do. As they live a God-centered life, it will be a good life to them, because they will experience the blessing of God in their life. They want to bless others. They experience compassion, so they give compassion. They experience grace, and so they give grace. They experience forgiveness, and so they give out forgiveness. They experience God's generosity, and so they give it out as well. No one forces them to, but they want to. Such is their love for God. And so for these 3 weeks, we're thinking about generous lives, and you're thinking, oh no, that Andrew's about to ask for money for the church. Because whenever we chat about money in the church, it's always the minister going, give us your money. But I don't want your money. I really don't. In fact, if you put £1 million on the plate today, or give it by bank transfer this week, I won't see a penny of it anyway, and I wouldn't want to do so. Because that's not what we're all about. What I want for you is to love God so much that your lives are irrevocably changed. I want you to have such a great and glorious view of your God, your Creator, your Savior, that you fall in love with him more each day. I want your hearts to be changed, to recognize that God cares for you, that he loves you, he looks out for you day by day, that God made the sun, the moon, the stars, the heavens and the earth, all of creation, for you to enjoy, that he gives you all that you have day by day, your family, your friends, your hobbies, your interests, your work, your home, all of that for you, that God created all of that so that you might enjoy him and enjoy the life that he gives to you. I want you to experience and know the blessing and joy of knowing that you're part of God's family through faith in Jesus. God didn't have to do these things for you, but he wanted to do these things for you. And then, and only then, if you've experienced that, if you're like this guy in a photo who's like, wow, God is amazing, that maybe just then you might hold less tightly to the stuff in your life, that your possessions, your time, your money, all of that stuff might kind of just seem like stuff to you. But I don't want you to cling tightly to your stuff. I want you to cling tightly to the God who loves you, that he might become your glorious joy, your ultimate hope, your abounding love. So yes, I do want you to be generous, but not for my sake, not even for the church's sake. But I want you to do it because it's evidence of God working in your life,
that your heart is bursting with gratitude and thankfulness and overflowing with love for God and what he's done for you. Because when people love God, they become big-hearted like God, and their hearts are changed by him. And so they begin to ask, if God did all of that for me, what am I going to do for him? If he can give his own son for me, surely I can give up some of my time for him. Surely I can give up some of my possessions for him. After all, he gave it to me firstly. And so if God did give all of that for you, all of creation, all of your daily provision, and all of salvation, what might you do for him? Let's pray. Loving and generous God, we marvel at how generous you are, that you've never had to do anything for us, you've never been forced to do it, but you give us all of life and all of its beauty and richness and color and variety out of love for us. We thank you for the beauty of creation. We thank you for living in such a beautiful part of the world and for the chance to see places across the world when we go on holiday and even just watch programs on the telly and see pictures of creation. We thank you for its majesty, its beauty, its variety. And God, we thank you for the daily provision in our life, for the food that we eat, the water in our taps, the homes that shelter us, the clothes on our back, our family, our friends, our hobbies and interests, all the variety of life. And God, we thank you for salvation, that we could not earn a place in your family, but out of love, you adopt us as your children. You bring us back into a relationship with you, not because you have to, but because you want more of us to experience your love. So God, may it be the case that as we reflect and remember of how good and how generous you have been to us, that we might hold less tightly onto stuff and to our time and to our possessions and talents, but that we might live like you, to be abundantly generous, to love others and serve others in the way that you have first loved us. Bless us in this, encourage us in this, challenge us in this, we ask. For we pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing of a song that speaks of how God is glorious and good to us. To God be the glory, great things he has done. So may you go and live generous lives as you marvel at God's generosity to you first. May the blessing of God be with you and all who you love, today and forevermore. Amen.
And please take a seat. And a reminder about, as we're talking about, being generous and being able to serve if you can. There's chances to serve by the food list here. So leave it as you go out if you feel able to do any of those things.